Good evening, all. Why don't we go ahead and start? Let's stand together. Our Father, we want to dedicate our evening to you. We want to thank you, Lord, for each one here. And if anyone's coming, Lord, just give them the safety in this rain. And I know a lot of people probably stayed home because of it. We thank you. Thank you for the water. You bless us in so many ways. Father, we are looking forward to one tonight. We ask that you prepare us, you prepare our hearts, our minds. We give them to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Set us free, no longer to be subject to the yoke of slavery. So we're rejoicing in God's victory, our hearts responding to his love. Jesus, we celebrate your victory. Set us free, Jesus, your death has brought us life. His spirit in us, releasing us from fear, and the way to him is open. With boldness we draw near, and in his presence our problems disappear.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Take a minute or two and say hello to someone.
Thank you. Father, we want to thank you for bringing us to your house tonight, Lord. We want to thank you for your presence here, Lord God, for it's true. You do meet us here, Lord. And Father, thank you for the rain that you're pouring on our land, God. You're merciful. You're faithful. We pray, Lord God, that you would rain in our hearts tonight, Lord God. That you would pour your Holy Spirit, God, in us, and you would teach us, Lord, by your Holy Spirit tonight, Lord. Make the Word of God alive, Father. And do in us those things we can't do in ourselves, Lord God. Please, Lord, we look to you, Lord God. Bless your people. In Jesus' name we pray, Father. Amen. Please be seated. Hopefully you brought all about your Bibles tonight. We're in Revelation chapter 4, and it's only 11 verses, so we'll go through the whole 11 verses. We want to read through those verses. So turn with me to Revelation chapter 4. And it says this, after these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. Immediately I was in the spirit, and I behold a throne set in heaven. And one sat on the throne, and he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardis stone in appearance. And there was a rainbow all around the throne, in appearance like an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and on the throne I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white robes. And they had crowns of gold on their heads, and from the throne proceeded lightnings, thundering, and voices. Seven lamps of fire were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Before the throne there was a sea of glass like crystal, and in the midst of the throne and around the throne were four living creatures, full of eyes in front and in back. The first living creature was like a lion, and the second living creature was like a calf. The third living creature had a face like a man, and the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle. The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within. And they do not rest day or night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fell down before him who sits on the throne and worships him who lives forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. I want to remind each of us before we go into Revelations tonight that there's something that Jesus made a statement concerning the book of Revelation. And this is a statement, blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. So in the book of Revelation, Jesus wants us to know, when we go into the book of Revelation, it's not a scary book, it's a book that's to bless you as a Christian. That's really important. Now, John is on the island of Patmos. He has been put there for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. In other words, he has been teaching the word of God, and a lot of the leaders have a problem with it, and they want him to die. And they try to kill John, They try to boil him, but he doesn't boil. And so they put him on the Isle of Patmos. But he's not only in trouble because of the word of God that he teaches, he's in trouble because he's a good witness. His life reflects Christ in everything he does. He is a man that's led by the Spirit. He has love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, kindness, goodness. All the fruits of the Spirit are coming forth out of his life. And he lives for Jesus. So that's very intimidating to the world and the people who are into religion. So John's on the Isle of Patmos. And the Bible says he is taken in the Spirit and he sees Jesus. And Jesus tells him to write down these things which you have seen and the things which are and the things which will take place after this. So far in the book of Revelation, we have seen the history of the church are the seven churches. The first three chapters were about history. I want to remind you of that. Each church represented a time of history in the world. And the last being the church of Laodicea, which was about from 1900 until the end concerning the rapture happening, then the church age ends. So the church here, as we start in chapter 4, it is no longer here. It's gone. And where does it go? We will see in a moment, the Bible teaches that the church will be gone. It'll be raptured. Before this, in the first three chapters, the church is mentioned 19 times. But after chapter 4 we start on, the church is not mentioned anymore. And that's why we believe, without a doubt, the scripture will teach us that the rapture of the church happens at that point. So let's start on our teaching tonight, and let's go to verse 1. Does anybody need a Bible? If you need a Bible, raise your hand. We'll get you a Bible so you can go along or follow along with us. Thank you, Jimmy. And we're going to be skipping to different chapters, so get ready to do some page flipping. Verse 1 says, after these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. After this, he is speaking here of after the things of the church or the church age. Remember, the church age started when Jesus, or when the Holy Spirit came upon them in the book of Acts. They received the Holy Spirit. That was the beginning of the church. And we will see in this chapter that the church is no longer here. The church age is over. Okay? It says here, and the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up hither. So after the church age, the church is gone, Jesus calls the church up. We call this the rapture. Every Christian will hear this voice. Every Christian. When the last person gets saved before this event, these words will be spoken by Jesus as they come up hither. In about 1978, my wife and I, we both got saved. We accepted Christ. I think I was 27 years old when we got born again. From that point on, it wasn't long before we learned about the rapture of the church, that Jesus Christ was coming for the church. And from ever since then, I wanted the Lord to take us home. The Bible teaches here, this is exactly what is going to happen. I want you to turn with me to the book of Thessalonians, chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians, chapter 4. And we're going to read exactly what the Bible speaks about concerning the rapture of the church, the rapture of every Christian. They will hear the voice of Christ and they'll be risen. Taken out of here. First Thessalonians chapter 4, and I know most of you know about this, and you've read it many times, and I've taught on it many different times, but I believe it's more reality now than ever before. Starting on verse 13, tell me when you're there. First Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. Here we go. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring with him those who have died in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep or those who have died. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. And then he says these words in this last verse, 18, therefore comfort one another with these words. First of all, the first beginning of this, he says, I don't want you to be ignorant. I want you to understand what's going to happen. There's going to be a rapture of the church, and here's how it's going to be. The dead in Christ, those who Christians who have already died, their bodies are going to be resurrected. And then those who remain on the earth, those Christians, are going to be taken up, and up they go to heaven. This is what Jesus is saying, come up hither. Same words, same truth, same meaning. But notice at the end there, verse 18 again, therefore comfort one another with these words. These words are to comfort, not to be afraid or fear of what God's going to do. Now, on those same lines, let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51 through 53, talking about the rapture of the church. 1 Corinthians 15, 51. You there? Here we go. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all die, but we shall all be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable. And we shall be changed, for this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. So this is what we call the rapture of the church. This is what you and I are looking forward to in the days that we live. And this is the next prophetic thing to happen scripturally that the Bible teaches is going to happen. It's next thing in line is the rapture of the church. Now, this story kind of shows us what the rapture will be like. And this called three crew sailed into oblivion. Listen to it. Among the ships that have been found adrift and deserted for no apparent reason, the most mysterious was the abandoned schooner discovered in mid-Atlantic in 1881 by Ellen Austin, an American vessel. Everything was in order, nothing was missing, and no signs of a struggle were visible. Soon after, a crew from the Ellen Austin had been put aboard, and the two ships had started for port. A squall separated them, and the schooner was located a few hours later, and she was again deserted. Another crew was finally persuaded to go aboard. Another squall once more separated the vessels, and the schooner and the men were never seen and heard again. So I want to share with you what it's going to kind of like be after the rapture happens, because I think this is my thoughts. First of all, I can't wait till the rapture happens. I'm ready for the rapture to happen. Spiritually, I want God to come. Because I see so many things happening in our world that are so evil. But I'm reminded continually that the God of this world is a devil, the Bible says. And he's the one that's ruling and reigning in this world. And this is what is the byproduct of him ruling and reigning. Now, let me share with you a few things that are going to happen after we're raptured. The rapture of the church is going to be worldwide. For there are true believers in Jesus Christ in every country on earth. And they all shall be taken. Every country will find itself in turmoil. Each government will have to act as quickly as possible to prevent a wide tide of anarchy and terrorism. Strong measures will be put in effect. Millions of people will suddenly disappear from the face of the earth, including all the infant children. From all walks of life and from virtually every phase of life, there shall be people missing. The freeways, the subways, the airports, and the streets will be in shambles as many engineers, pilots, bus drivers, and a multitude of private car owners shall suddenly be caught up out of the world. It will be many days before they can unscramble the mangled cars, the trains, and the fallen aircrafts. There will be also remaining billions of people who will be wailing, dazed and shaken by the event. This shall be trying to locate loved ones in all the rubble of the broken cars and amid broken storefronts and smashed residences. Communication will be greatly disrupted. Many key persons shall disappear, and much of the line of communications, which are still above the ground, will be broken by crashes of cars and aircraft. Distraught and searching multitudes will jam and overload the communication lines and systems that do remain. Policemen, firemen, and rescue crews will work around the clock. Hospitals will overflow. Emergency shelters and first aid stations will be inadequate. The Red Cross and all other emergency units, plus the army facilities, will still not be enough. Opportunists will add to the confusion and the misery by looting and killing. Chaos will be everywhere. That is just a small picture that will happen. And my thoughts after that is, thank you, Jesus, that we won't be here. Many believe that in order for the United States to have the fall that it needs to fall, although it is falling quickly right now, that this is what's going to cause the United States to collapse economically in every single way. The rapture of the church. If there are a lot of Christians in America, let's just say there is 10%, and they are in every single field, in every kind of position. Imagine 10% of Americans being removed. What is the world going to be like? People have asked me the question, when we're in heaven, are we able to look down on earth and see what's happening? I don't know. I really don't know. The Bible doesn't say whether we will be able to. But I believe that we'll be rejoicing so much that we won't worry about the earth at that point. But my concern is mainly the people will be left behind. Yes, babies will be taken, but there's going to be many relatives of ours, children, grandchildren, of the age of accountability. They're going to be left behind, and you're going to be in this shambles. And I wish this on nobody, even my worst enemies, if I had any, and I'm sure I do, I wouldn't want this to happen in their lives. Now, I believe, as Christians, it is in our lifetime that this is going to happen. These are not just words that God wrote down and, you know what, one day in the by and by, we see all the truth concerning the birth pangs that Jesus speaks about that are happening in our world today like never before and increasing. But I believe as Christians, and that's who I'm concerned about right now also, are mainly, that we need to be ready for this, every one of us. Jesus talked about the coming tribulation period and said this in Luke 21, verse 34. But take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and the cares of this life. And that day come on you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the earth. Watch, therefore, and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. Well, Jesus in this scripture, when this question was asked, what should we be doing? Jesus said, you need to do two things. And he warns them. He says, watch and pray. It's pretty simple. It's really not hard in the sense of Jesus is not giving us, you know, deep things, although he's given us deep things on how to prepare for these coming days. I must be alert. I must be awake. I need not be sleeping. And I need to be praying. That way God works in my heart. God strengthens my heart. And I pray for the lost. Now, to the Church of Philadelphia, Jesus wrote this in Revelation 3:10. Because you have kept my commandment to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world, to test those who dwell on the earth. So he tells this church, and this is a church we want to be in, as we learned. They will go up in the rapture without a doubt. But they were a church that persevered. They kept on keeping on, doing what they needed to do every day. That's what we as Christians need to do. There are many today in the church who are sleeping. And I mean spiritually sleeping. And God's desire is for us to be awake. God wants us to persevere, keep on doing what he's called us to do until our life is over, until the rapture of the church happens. Whether you go home with the Lord before the rapture or whether you go home with the Lord in the rapture. But we need to be doing what God called us to do. Now, right after the rapture will come the great tribulation. And we'll be going through the chapters as we go through chapter 6 through 19. That'll speak about all that is going to happen during that great tribulation. But something else is going to happen. Believers in Jesus are going to receive new bodies, first of all. When I was young, I remember being flexible. When I was younger, I was pretty flexible. And I'm still pretty flexible because I stretch a lot, but I'm still like, man, I just... There used to be a song, "The Old Gray Mare, She Ain't What She Used to Be." I think all of us feel that way sometimes. But the Bible teaches that at this time when the rapture happens, you and I are going to get brand new bodies, glorified bodies. What are these bodies going to be like? We can look at Jesus when he had his glorified body, and we can kind of see. Jesus walked through walls. All of a sudden he appears. Boom, he's there. I think he didn't. He ascended into heaven, but I think he was instantly in heaven. I think when we think about it, we'll be where we want to be. We'll never be sick. If you want long hair, you can have long hair. If you want blonde hair, I think you can have it. If you want blue eyes, you can have blue eyes. But I don't think it's going to matter to you at all. Because you're not going to be vain anymore. But in that time, right after the rapture, you as a Christian, the Bible teaches, are going to receive brand new bodies, heavenly bodies. There's another thing that's going to happen, and I'm only going to mention three, but there are more. There's going to be the time of receiving rewards. We call it the Bema Seat Judgment. than the Bible speaks of. It is where we receive our rewards, not heaven, because you already are in heaven. You've already been given the gift of heaven through Jesus Christ, and that is of grace. But the Bible teaches in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse 10, that God has appointed us to do certain things with our lives, as we will learn at the end of this chapter more. God has prepared us to do certain things for His kingdom. So when we get to heaven, those things or those gifts or talents that God gave to each one of us, we're going to be rewarded for, or we're not going to be rewarded for. That is called the Bema Seat Judgment. There are different crowns the Bible teaches. I believe there's 7 of them that will be given. Not to every person, but to the person who did what the Word of God said concerning those crowns. One of them is one of sharing the gospel and bringing people to Christ. That's going to be, a person's going to get a crown for that. Now, eternity is a long time. I don't know if you know that. It's a long time. It never ends. I try to look at eternity this way. If we were to get a turtle, a small little turtle, and we were to put a ball bearing in front of his nose, and he was to go around the world, eternity is kind of like this. A turtle going around the world, pushing a ball, wearing the world out. That's how long eternity is. So when I get to heaven, I want to make sure that there are things that, because of what I've done, God rewards me for, those things will be with me for eternity. And yes, one day if I get crowns, I'll lay them at the feet of Jesus, but they'll be given back to me. We can send things to heaven beforehand, and part of this is doing the will of God with our lives and what He's called us to do. There's one more thing, the marriage supper of the Lamb, where Christ marries the bride. And how many know what the bride is, or who the bride is? The church. It'll be a feasting time, and it'll be a marriage time. Now, He says, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place. John will show these things that concern the future, which must take place after this, after the rapture. Verse 2 says, and immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, the throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne, and he who sat was like a jasper and a sardis stone in appearance. And there was a rainbow around the throne in appearance like an emerald. The first thing that is mentioned, all of a sudden John, although he is walking in the Spirit, now he's in the Spirit. And it's something I want to touch on just lightly. John is saying literally that he's totally in the Spirit. I don't think any of us have ever walked totally in the Spirit. I'm not saying that the Holy Spirit haven't led us and guided us and filled us. And I'm not saying you haven't had the fruit of the Holy Spirit. But the way that John is speaking about here is literally being totally engulfed in the Spirit of God. And there's one day that's going to happen to every Christian. And it will cause us to not live in the flesh ever again. Imagine that. Every day you deal with the flesh, and it's not easy, have you noticed? I hate my flesh, and that battle that goes on, that is spoken in Galatians, seems to never stop. It says in Galatians that the flesh wars against the Spirit, and the Spirit wars against the flesh, and they are contrary one to another, that you may not do the things that you wish. That's a constant battle. When we get to heaven, you'll never have to deal with the flesh again, ever. nor will you have to deal with the carnal mind. Now, I know every one of you today had different thoughts. Not all your thoughts were perfect. Not one of you, your thoughts were perfect. I'm not saying you didn't have good thoughts. That's not what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is that we all have that mind, that carnal mind, that is an enmity against the things of God. The Bible says we will have the mind of Christ. Man, I can't wait. That's one of the big things I'm looking forward to, one of the biggest things. And it says, one that sat on the throne. This throne is not empty. There is someone who sits on the great heavenly throne. The throne is a powerful declaration of not merely God's presence, but his sovereign, rightful reign and his prerogative to judge. John was not to pass this on to those he loved, for they were going through much persecution and sorrow, so God was trying to minister to them these truths. There is a throne in heaven, and Jesus sits on it and rules and reigns from there, overseeing all things that happen on the earth and things that happen in our lives as Christians. We have that assurance he is in control. Now look at me. Look up so you can get something. Come on, look up. We see our world that's in a topsy-turvy. We've never seen the confusion that we've seen in our world, worldwide. We've never seen the evil, at least I never have seen the kind of evil that is happening right now. They're trying to put a bill through California where they can kill a baby after it's born. Someone told me 30 days, another person told me 5. So, 6 weeks. 6 weeks. Could you imagine your wife gives birth to a baby? There's that little boy, our little girl, beautiful as it is. You start to attach yourself to it, you hug it, you kiss it, you feed it, you love it, and all of a sudden, you decide to kill it. You put it in a dumpster like somebody did the other day. How sickening can that be? But the Bible teaches that even though we see these things, and God allows this to happen because man has a free choice and a free will, Jesus Christ is still in control of everything that is happening. His end result that he said in his word is still going to happen. God promises. All these things that are going on today are things you and I do not have to be afraid of. For Jesus is orchestrating them all. He is fulfilling before our eyes the things that he said would happen in the last days. When I see what's happening in the world today, the Bible speaks of these things. And it strengthens my faith, and it should strengthen your faith if you know the Word of God. You and I can rest in the arms of Jesus and his promises because Jesus does not just sit on the throne. He rules and reigns. That's what the King of Kings does. These world rulers are just pawns in the hand of God. I want you to listen to what C.H. Spurgeon says on this thought. O child of God, thy heavenly Father in his sovereignty has a right to do with you, his child, as he pleases. But he will never let that sovereignty get out of the limit of the covenant. As a sovereign, he might cast you away, but he has promised that he never will, and he never will. As a sovereign, he might leave you to perish, but he has said, I will not leave thee nor forsake thee. As a sovereign, he might suffer you to be tempted beyond your strength, but he has promised that no temptation shall happen to you, but such as is common to man, and he will, with the temptation, make a way of escape. Now the scriptures says this. It says here that Jesus sits on the throne. He sits there also because he has completed salvation for man, all mankind, through Jesus Christ. He makes a mention of a jasper and a sardis stone in appearance. Instead of describing a specific form of figure, John describes the emanation of glistening light in two colors, white, jasper may mean diamond, and red, sardis. God is light. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. And there was a rainbow around the throne. The throne is surrounded by a green-hued rainbow in appearance like an emerald. The rainbow is a reminder of God's commitments to his covenant with men. I want you to turn with me, and you're going to see why in just a moment, to Genesis chapter 9, the very first book in the Bible. And we're going to read why we have rainbows. Genesis 9, verse 11 says, I'm getting there. Thus, establish my covenant with you. Never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood. Never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is a sign of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I set my rainbow in the clouds, and it shall be for the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. It shall be when I bring a cloud over the earth that the rainbow shall be seen in the clouds. And I'll remember my covenant with which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. The water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. The rainbow shall be in the cloud, and I will look at on it to remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. And God said to Noah, this is a sign of a covenant which I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth. I wanted you to know and be reminded about this, because many times people look at the rainbow differently than what God says that rainbow is. When I look at the rainbow and I see a beautiful rainbow, I think about this covenant that God's made with all men, that he'll never flood the earth again, ever. That's what a rainbow represents. Okay? The rainbow also signifies grace and peace and promise from God. Through the grace of God comes all the blessings of God. Peace, God is not at war with mankind because of Jesus. God has made a way to remove the enmity between him and man, Calvary. Verse 4 says, and around the throne were 24 thrones. And on the throne I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their heads. So we see 24 elders. These may be created beings representing the Old and New Testament, or the church in heaven. Some believe that they can be angels, but I believe that they are the leaders of the 12 tribes of Israel, and I believe that they are the 12 prophets, or the apostles of Jesus. And these 24 elders are going to sing a song of the church. In chapter 5 of this same book, the song is written, and let me read it to you. The 24 elders sing a song of praise to Jesus, and they cry out, for you were slain, and you have redeemed us to God by your blood. out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation. In that passage, the 24 elders are clearly speaking as representatives of God's people, of the great company of the redeemed. Verse 5, and from the throne proceeded lightnings, thunders, and voices. Seven lamps of fire were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. The seven spirits of God is the fullness of the Holy Spirit that is around the throne. But let me read to you, it's in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2, what these seven things are that the Holy Spirit has. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The spirit of wisdom, the spirit of understanding, the spirit of counsel, the spirit of might, the spirit of knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. Verse 6. Before the thrones, there was a sea of glass like crystal. And in the midst of the throne and all around the throne were four living creatures full of eyes, in front and in back. The first living creature was like a lion. The second living creature, like a calf. The third living creature had a face like a man. And the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle. The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within. And they do not rest day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Well, we see four living creatures here. For comparison, these are same creatures are mentioned in Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 4 through 14, and Ezekiel chapter 10, 20 through 22. We understand these creatures as being cherubims. Cherubims, they say, are the most powerful angels in heaven, the most powerful angels created by God. In fact, the Bible teaches that there was another angel that was a cherub that rebelled against God because of pride, because he wanted to be worshipped like God. He led the choir in heaven. His name is Satan. It's spoken of in Ezekiel 28:14. But the eyes are in front and back, full of eyes all around within. The multitude of their eyes indicate these living creatures are not blind instruments or robots. They know and understand and have greater insight and perception than any man. These beings of incredible intelligence and understanding live their existence to worship God. Now all fail to truly worship is rooted in the lack of seeing and understanding who God is and his greatness. Let me tell you why I said that last part. It is because of this. God desires for us to be worshiped because God deserves worship. And once you realize who God really is, once you see that God is who he says he is, it's not hard to worship God. But until you see God in that place of who he is and his greatness, until he reveals himself to you, in the deepness that he desires, then it all becomes superficial. It can be just songs. When we were younger, my wife and I, we went to a different church, and I'm not putting the church down in any way, don't misunderstand me, but we sing songs all about what God does for us. That's all we sang. And I'm not saying those songs are bad, so don't misunderstand me. But when we started attending Calvary Chapel, we began to worship God about, it was all about God. How great thou art, that's a wonderful song. It's about him. Who are we singing to? You're so great, God. But Calvary Chapel brought in a lot of songs that's totally, as you sang them, you were talking to God, literally. That's how they are. And that's what God desires, and that's what God desires from you. There's a special intimacy that you have with God when you enter in this kind of worship, enter into this kind of praise. You might see somebody lift their hands up, and you might see them cry and weep, and you think they're putting on a show maybe, or Boy, they get touched so easy. That's not really what's happening. They are having this intimate time with God. Now, it says here, like a lion, like a calf, a face like a man, and like a flying eagle. John describes four cherubims, each with a different face. Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 6 to 10 speaks of this. And we can see each of these cherubims have four faces. Now listen, each cherubim has four faces. Okay, not one, but four. John sees each one of the four different faces pointing in his direction. The significance of this four, or these four faces, have been interpreted in many ways. The four different faces of cherubims are often taken as symbols of Jesus as represented in each gospel. In the classical church architecture, these four characters are repeated often as a main element that signifies both heaven and the four gospels. Most have seen Matthew as a lion gospel, showing Jesus as a lion of the tribe of Judah. Mark is seen as the ox gospel, showing Jesus as a humble servant, a worker. Luke is seen as a man gospel, showing Jesus as a perfect man, the second Adam. And John is seen as the eagle gospel, showing Jesus as a man from heaven, the sky. But this approach also has other interpretation. He goes on. They do not rest day or night, saying, "Holy, holy, holy." So the cherubims, these angels, constantly repeat the phrase, "Holy, holy, holy." It speaks of God's nature and God's character. In other words, God is perfect. And then it mentions here, the Lord God Almighty. The cherubims declare the Lord God is Almighty. As in Revelation 1:8, the ancient Greek word has the same idea of the one who has his hand on everything. I don't know about you, but I sure like that. I want God's hand to be on everything in my life. I want God's hand to be on everything in my children's life and my grandchildren's life and everything on this church. I want God's hand to be on it and on the earth. And God, his hand is on it. So let me ask you a question. Do you believe that God's hand is on everything? To turn it where he wants? I do. I completely believe that God controls all that is happening today and the future that is happening in the world today. I believe that God controls yours and my future, whether it is a divine appointment or a person we marry or the home we buy, if we let him. That's the key. If we surrender. Well, why did I buy that house and I lost it? Or why did I do this? And because you didn't allow God to make your decision. You made your own decision. That's the truth. If you will believe this as a Christian, and allow the Lord to make your decisions for your life, you can walk in peace like you have never experienced before, and you can stay in that peace if you do this. This does not mean that you will not have trials, but it means that you can walk through these trials on a level ground with a peace that surpasses all understanding that will fill your heart and fill your mind. Verse 9, whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him, who sits on the throne and worship him, who lives forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, honor, and power. For you created all things, and by your will, they exist and were created. I want you to be reminded that this is happening today in heaven right now as we sit here. This is happening in heaven. We will see this one day, but it's happening today. The Bible says here that the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship. These 24 elders worship, which really means to credit worth our worthiness to God. The elders credit God for their own work and reward, and they do this as they cast their crown before the throne. They recognize that the worthiness belongs to God, not to them. Beloved, let me ask this question to you. And look at me for a minute. What is God worth to you? In other words, how important is God in your life? Now stop for a second. I'm going to wait for about 10 seconds to let you think about that. Because I don't want you to say, because this is a real cop-out for many Christians many times. Well, God's everything to me. He knows I love him. He's the most important person. But when you stop and you're honest with God and you listen and you wait, many times it's different than what you think. From 1 to 10, where is the importance to you or the meaning concerning your life concerning God? 1 to 10, what would you say? Imagine if God hadn't saved you and wasn't in your life. Where would you be today? What kind of life would you have? Would you even be alive, for some of us? What choice would you have made if he had not intervened in your life? What would your life be like without Jesus? I cannot imagine where I would be without God today. If I were alive, I would have probably not had my wife or my children, but for sure the family of God. I would have not had the life I have now, one with such purpose. So I'm trying to do this to you tonight in this passage. I want you to think about the worth of God concerning the meaning of life and the life that you now have because of him. So how valuable is he to you? I think you need to move him up the scale from 1 to 10. If you're at 2, or he's at 2, or 3, or 4, he needs to be moved up. Your answer should be, he's everything. In these scriptures, there is also an allusion made to a practice known in the Roman Empire. The emperors of Rome ruled over many lesser kings, and these kings were at times commanded to come before the emperor and lay their crowns down before him in homage. Then he would give them back as a demonstration that their crowns, their right to rule, their victory came from him. This is an allusion to the custom of prostrations in the East and to the homage of petty kings acknowledging the supremacy of the emperor. Spurgeon wrote this, "Our text says they all cast their crowns before the throne. There are no divided opinions in heaven, no sects or parties, no schisms there. They are all in perfect harmony and sweet accord. What one does, all do. They cast their crowns without exception before the throne. Let us begin to practice that harmony here. As fellow Christians, let us get rid of everything that would divide us from each other or separate us from our Lord. I do not read that there was a single elder who envied his brother's crown and said, "Ah, I wish I was such as one as he is and had his crown." I do not read that one of them began to find fault with his brother's crown and said, "Ah, his jewels may be bright, but mine have a peculiar tint in them, and they are of greater excellency." I do not read out of dissension. They were all unanimous in casting their crowns at Jesus' feet. They were all unanimous in glorifying God. The scripture also speaks this: "Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things." I want to read a scripture concerning that same thought, that God, really, the second person of the Trinity, Jesus, has created all things. Everything you see, all those mountains, all the beauty that is in the world, Jesus created. Listen to what Colossians 1, 16 and 17 says: "For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions, our principalities, our powers, are all things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist." In other words, without God, nothing that is held together right now can consist. In other words, it falls apart. That's how it works. And then he ends with this part: "And for thy pleasure they are and were created." This reminds us that we each exist to give glory and pleasure to God. So stop for a moment and think, why were you created? What are your thoughts concerning why God made you? What are your thoughts concerning why God created you? Why God saved you? What are your thoughts? Just a little reminder for all of us: we were made for God. He was not made for us. We are his creation. We didn't create him. We can sometimes forget this. We can think and even believe that God exists for our good being. The scripture teaches us here that we were made for his good pleasure. We were made to please him. Listen to what Proverbs 16:4 says: "The Lord has made all things for himself. Yes, even the wicked, for the day of evil." In Romans 11:36, he says, "For everything comes from him and exists by his power and is intended for his glory. All glory to him forever. Amen." And that same scripture in a different translation, it says this: "For from him and through him and for him are all things. To him is the glory forever. Amen." Now, Solomon makes this statement in Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 17. "Therefore I hate life, because the work that is wrought under the sun is grievous to me. For all is vanity and vexation." Solomon was living for himself, for his own glory. When he wrote this, he had walked away from God, the purpose of life. The Bible teaches that there is a purpose for life, that God created you and he had a plan for you before you were even born. God said this to Jeremiah in Jeremiah 1:5, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before you came forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations." The Lord said to Paul, the apostle, he is a chosen vessel unto me. Later, Paul speaks of being separated from the purpose of God, from his mother's womb. Right into the Romans, he speaks of the predestined and destined plan of God for his life. So, beloved, we were created for God's good pleasure. We bring him pleasure when we are obedient to his will, and when we have faith in him and we walk in his spirit. There are so many people who are looking for fulfillment, but they end up just like Solomon, empty. You can't find a more successful man in the sense of worldly goods, worldly accomplishments, than Solomon. And your thoughts may be, he should be completely happy. He has every kind of riches. He's accomplished more than any man, just about, except for Jesus, probably. He has 1,000 wives. Poor guy. And he's miserable, incomplete. Again, the Bible teaches when a man realizes and recognizes that he was made for God's good pleasure, that man becomes fulfilled, he becomes satisfied, and his life has purpose. That's where God wants us all to be. I hope I've convinced you tonight that you were made for one reason, for God's pleasure, to please God. And when I do that, my life has meaning, purpose, and fulfillment, no matter who you are. Father, we are grateful for the Word of God, and we thank you, Lord God, that you sit on the throne, that you rule and reign, that you are in control of all things, that those people out there who are making all kinds of decisions, God, you have to approve of, Lord. You have to let them make those decisions. And Father, we thank you that in our lives, it's the same way. As we yield and we surrender to you, you make, Father, our lives to be what you desire them to be, Lord God, and to accomplish through us what you want to accomplish through us. So we surrender ourselves over to you, Lord. We give our wills over to you, and we say, Lord, have your way in us, Lord God. We acknowledge also, God, that we were made to please God. That's why we were created, Lord. So, Lord, never let us forget that, Lord God. And may we please you because we love you, Lord. Thank you for the life that you've given us, Lord God. There's nothing like it. And thank you for the promise, Lord God, that you made of the rapture, God. That one day soon, God, you'll snatch us away, Lord. And we'll see these things live, not memorex. In Jesus' precious name we pray, Father. Amen.